Dude, I'm so excited to be doing this.
Thank you.
Great Christian James Hand is here. I didn't know your name. I thought it was the session live. Before we get into what we're going to do, I want to know how we even get here. I'll say that it was so cool to have an experience like those live sessions. What I mean is you have an Instagram handle, which is at the session
IG live.
At the session IG live. I was put onto it by my friend Karen. Shout out to KG, who has been experiencing those for a while now. And what we were texting one day, and I was in a hotel, and she was like, "Oh, you know, in an hour, an hour from now, that thing I told you about, that right. guy's going to go live." And she goes, "And doesn't save them. They're not archived."
Yeah, it's no archive.
Which I got to say is a very cool. It feels like a throwback.
Yeah, you know, thank you.
There's like a nostalgic kind of quality to being like, either you're there or you're not.
If you're not there, you're done.
You miss yep. it. You can miss it. And we're doing the opposite today because we're actually recording this. But it's good because it kind of serves, it'll like be a taste of what it usually is. And what happened was I was like, okay, I'll check this out. And, correct me if I'm not describing it correctly, but it was a breakdown of that day. Was Tears for Fears, right?
Shout.
Yep. And you strip down the instruments used in the song by the stems of the recording.
Yep.
So it could be like the keyboards, the vocals, the drums. But as you're doing that, so you're getting the song broken down and kind of reconstructed. There's also, you will say, well, you know, the guy that played this also played in this other band, and here's this song. So then other songs come up, other genres of music, songs you've never heard before, maybe songs you're familiar with, and it becomes like this ride, this musical adventurous ride that is so fun.
Thank you.
I mean, I was ear to ear just smiling, like experiencing something, and I was like, I can't wait for the next one. And then I was like, there's MJ Wednesdays? What the fuck? So yeah, I've been jumping in on those. Have you done, by the way, because one of the things I thought about, MJ's catalog is obviously so famous, and you know, we all grew up yeah. with it. You'll get so into like what you think of as like his hits. And then like recently I heard Rock My World, and I was, you know that song,
mm-hmm.
Michael Jackson's song?
Right? No.
You don't know that?
No, I'll check it on the ride home.
Oh my God. Because it's one of those, it was just like an addictive, you know, there's an addictive rhythm to it. And I was like, oh, I wonder if he's done this one.
Right.
Now I know you haven't, and you're going to fucking get those stems, man. But before I even, there's more I want to say about that. I want to know, like I was, you know, reading about like how we got to where you are today with music, like your background.
Okay.
How did you start in this music world?
Well, first off, thanks for having me. It's a great compliment when jaded people are interested in what I'm doing.
couldn't be more cynical. Let me tell you, I'm a sarcastic dick.
It's kind of your brand. It's one of the things you're known for. So when I was like, wait, Segura's in?
Yeah, then people sent me, they're like, you're such a great asshole comic. I'm like, thanks.
I think. I'm actually, the thing about the, when you said it was a throwback is, you know, I'm a radio guy. Like I wanted to be a radio. I'm actually from England. And
you have such a unique accent.
Speak,
you'll be like, this guy's American. You'll say a word, I'm like, where the fuck did he grow up? And then I was reading your bio, I was like, oh, it's a mix
there
mash
it is.
Of everything.
Yeah. So I, you know, the people that I grew up on doing radio in the UK were just planet smashers, like names that mean nothing to Americans other than probably maybe John Peel. So I wanted to do radio. So I came to America in high school, and then I went to college outside Manhattan, and I was on my college radio station. And I was like, all right, cool. I guess that's my college. That's my radio career.
Sure.
That's cool. So through a
friend. I did college radio as well.
It's the best place to do radio because you can do fucking anything.
I was on air, and then I managed the radio station.
Nice.
And it was a great learning experience and so fun.
What college was that?
It was a very, very small school in North Carolina called Lenore Ryan.
Wow.
But then I no one's heard.
No one's even heard of it.
That sounds like a rash. I'm like, no, it's a school. But they would, you know, I ended up having relationships with like Def Jam and Tommy Boy. And like, you know, getting, we would get the
promos.
Vinyl. Yeah, man. And I was so obsessed with hip hop that like, that's all I cared about receiving.
Yeah.
And then, but we had a full mix of talent because different students had different interests, and it was really fun, man.
Well, that to me was the great thing about college radio, was that it was one radio station, but it had 50 different radio stations yes. on it, because it was the metal kid, and then it was the fucking the gay guys that just talked about being gay, yeah, and then there yeah. was the, you know, it was like NPR, but on steroids with the guys from Jackass, half of it.
In college, at the college radio station is where I learned that you need scratch needles to scratch.
Oh,
records.
Yeah, of course. Yeah, yeah.
I was like, oh, I
I'll
run
just
this.
Use the ones.
I was like, and people were like, you're destroying our equipment.
A, you just destroyed the equipment, and B, you just really fucked your records
up. Oh, it's all fucked up. Yeah.
It's a total disaster. Yeah. So I did radio in college and thought that that was it. And then when I graduated, I went out on the road with a group called PM Dawn, and I, who are, you yeah, know,
amazing,
amazing, incredible. Amazing people.
And how did you get hooked up with them? just from radio relationships?
No. So I did. So I played in it. It's a little convoluted. I played in an industrial band in New York. And one of the guys that got me into the industrial band, because he knew the kids from the band, ended up through really weird happenstance becoming the tour manager for PM Dawn. And I'd actually gone to college to be a lighting designer. And he hit me up and was like, hey, PM Dawn needs a light guy. Do you want to come and do lights with us? And I was like, where do I sign?
Yeah.
So I went to do lights, and then the budget got cut, and I'd become at that point really, really good friends with Prince B. And I went to him and I was like, yeah, man, they cut my budget. And he was like, nah, that ain't happening. Let's find a job for you. So I became sort of like state ad hoc stage manager, drum tech, and then toured with them for 2 years, which was just like just bananas. Like we did the first Peter Gabriel WOMAD tour that Pete headlined on, which was just us and Stereo MCs and Inner Circle, Lenny Kravitz, Crowded
Holy
House.
Shit,
Sinead O'Connor was like his guest and sang on. It was just like a month of just absolute magic. So I toured with them, and then when that tour ended, I needed a job. So B got me a job at the record label, which was a label called G Street, which had Dougie Fresh and the Stereo MCs and the Jungle Brothers. Mm-hmm. And then they put out a record by an organization called the Grave Diggers.
Yeah.
Which was Prince Paul, Fruquam, Poetic, and the RZA. And I ended up, the label, it should be a movie. The label ended up putting me on the road with them to be like the label spy guy. And mm-hmm. and I was like, fuck you. Like, yeah. I love these dudes. Like, yeah. These dudes are crazy. Like, this yeah. is my gang right
yeah,
here.
Yeah, yeah.
So I ended up being like the token white guy on the road with this ridiculous organization.
Yeah.
And then the RZA actually left the tour in Europe. So Prince Paul's idea was he created a character called MC Skullcap, which was me. And I filled in for the RZA on the tour.
What?
Well, because the thing was, I knew all of the parts because I had it. Prince Paul was like, because he's Prince Paul. Like,
yeah.
The dude is a clown who just is a genius. Yeah. And just doesn't give a fuck. So he was like, yo, man, because we, so this, check out this tour, Segura. So we're in Europe. It's us, the Grave Diggers, Gangstar, Ice Cube, Public Enemy, J.Ru the Damager, and Arrested Development.
Oh my God.
And then Arrested Development quit. They left. So it was just those guys. And like, I'm on the road with Ice Cube and Public Enemy and Gangstar and just J.Ru. And it was just fucking ridiculous, dude.
That's crazy.
Touring Europe. So
that's one show? That's the show?
That was a tour. Yeah, that was the show. Like, you just showed up and then it was just pow, 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 pow. And then Cube and Public Enemy would flip headliner. So it would just go from, like, depending on which night you showed up, it was bananas. So just five podcasts worth of stories
tour alone. Is that early 90s when you're doing
this? Yeah, so this is like 90. I graduated in 92. That touring stuff stayed on basically until 96. So I was working at the label and touring backwards and forwards for
that's
that period.
That's a crazy show.
Crazy show. At that period,
God.
Like he had just put out like the you know, like Today Was a Good, like all of that stuff had just hit, and Public Enemy was like at the
peak. I've seen them live, and it's such an insane.
It's ridiculous.
Show. Yeah, and Arrested Development was one of the first shows I ever saw. Period.
Like with the full fucking compliment.
With the whole. Yeah.
That's why we were actually kind of relieved, honestly, when they decided to bail because everyone else was just turntables and mics, and these guys were like, "Oh my God, it's guitar center
like,
with
is
people."
Is there a choir coming out here? It's a lot.
How many drummers do you need to get that Mr. Wendell song accomplished?
Oh man, Mr. Wendell.
So I was on the road with them, and I think it was Public Enemy or Ice Cube had an intro like yo.
Yeah.
And we didn't have anybody. So Paul comes to me and he's like, yo, man, do you think you could do like the intro thing? And I'm like, yeah, dude, it's easy as pie. So they had a cordless mic. So I was sitting backstage and I'd do this intro. And then Paul was like, yo, man, it'd be kind of cool if you just like hype manned it and doubled all the words. Cause it just sounds like more people, which is part of the thing to get everybody. So I was like literally backstage with a joint in my hand being like, motherfucker, suck my dick. Can't believe it happened. Today was a Thursday. So when the RZA left the tour, we were sitting in the lobby of the hotel and the tour manager was sitting there. He was like, yeah, man, the RZA's bailed. And, you know, if we quit this tour, we're going to lose a boatload of cash, but we can keep going if you want to do it. And Fuquan was like, well, what are we going to do about the RZA? And Paul was like, Christian will just do it. And I was like, what are you talking about?
When he said, are other people like, are you out of your mind?
No, because it's Paul. So everyone's so like, yeah. Plus, you know, we've been on the road at that point. I knew those. I think we probably done like 4 months at that point.
So you knew
everybody. So I knew everybody. Yeah. And it was just literally, it was the four of us, a tour manager.
So now you're on stage?
So I'm on stage, like performing. Dressed in like full on ridiculous outfit, and like this is pre Eminem. Like this is like the only two other white guys doing it are Ice Cube and MC Search. I mean, I'm sorry, Vanilla Ice and MC Search. So then, like,
so like, how about at the shows? Are people like, hey?
Oh no, because
RZA got pale. Like,
yeah, like, and short.
Yeah,
but still just as high.
Yeah.
No, because Paul did this whole intro where he was like, we're going to introduce the great white hype out of Shaolin, like the dude that's going to be the next big thing. And then it was like MC Skullcap, and then I would come out and it would be like, oh.
And what would you wear it?
Oh, dude, because I was already, you know, I was a hip hop head. So I already had like the pants and the whole thing, but I went and bought like all of the cool Public Enemy hockey jerseys. Uh-huh. And then I had a really cool Gravediggers hockey jersey, which I still have. So I would just be the kid in hockey jerseys.
And like, would you do like a whole persona? Like,
oh, yeah, no,
hey,
it's terrible.
Yo, what's up? Like,
yo, what's going on, Antwerp? Just like, absolutely.
Dude, you performed on the
tour. Amazing.
This is crazy.
No, it was crazy. It was absolutely bananas.
Now, when RZA left the tour, was it to go make 36 Chambers?
No, so what had happened was, 36 Chambers. So the reason that they called themselves the Gravediggers was because their careers were dead. Because he had just, like, the Rakim thing had failed.
Uh-huh.
And Paul was kind of like, hadn't done Handsome Boy Modeling School or any of that shit. Because it's like coming off the tail end of Me, Myself, and I and all that stuff.
Yeah.
So he was like, I don't know what the fuck I'm doing. And the other two guys were from Stetsasonic. I don't know if you remember who.
I remember Stetsasonic.
So the Fruquam, Prince Paul, and Poetic, rest in peace. Though they were all in Stetsasonic.
Yeah.
So those two had no careers because at least Paul had, like, you know, dovetailed into production, doing other people's work. So RZA hit him up and was like, yo, man, let's just do this. They made up a thing called Horrorcore and they just called themselves the Gravediggers because their careers were dead.
Uh-huh.
So as that was happening, the 36 Chambers thing just started to creep up behind, and then that thing just fucking exploded. And RZA was like, I have to go do this.
I have to do this thing that's changing music.
Changing everything.
The genre.
Yeah. So it was the way that he did it. I'll tell that story at some point right before I die. The way he did it was kind of janky, but the bounce back of it was that we ended up just having this unbelievable fucking tour where I got to just be this caricature of my, like, I couldn't, like, I'd be on stage in front of like 30,000 kids losing their shit. I'm like, I don't even know what I'm doing here.
This is so insane. It's so crazy that you got to do that.
And then I would break down the turntables. Like, then I'd have to come back out.
Yeah, come back. You're like, where are we going? They're like, well, you're going back there. Yeah. Strike stuff. Yeah.
I got to take off my hockey jersey, put my hat on so I can surreptitiously look like the other, because otherwise I'm not getting laid.
Oh my God.
So my joke is that hip hop taught me how to smoke weed, because I was the only one on the bus when we did the US. I was the only one on the bus that Prince Paul didn't smoke, Fuquam didn't smoke, and Poetic came to me one day and was like, I can't smoke with this motherfucker anymore. Like, I need you to tap in, dude. And
really?
I was like, all right, man. And then the RZA would grab the back bus, the back lounge of the bus, and it would be like,
he could really smoke.
I mean, it's, you couldn't start the meeting until you were high. Like, that was the thing, like the creative process. I remember there was one day we went up to, there was a studio called Green Street, and he was like, yo, Skullcap, I need you to come and play drums. And I went up and it was like me and almost all the members of the Wu out to, like, you know, the 36th members. And I remember playing drums and the RZA, like, getting so frustrated because I didn't play like a broken, fucked up RZA beat. I was playing like a perfect drum beat.
Yeah,
and he was like, nah, man, I need it to. And I was like, and I was like, dude, nobody does that.
Like, thinks like you.
Only you think like
you. You have to smoke so much weed for your catchphrase end up being bong bong.
And the best part about it was that he would go. So he'd sit in the back of the bus and he would go on these like fucking stoned lectures that were just like, I wish I'd recorded all of them.
Like,
but the best part is like the only thing that I really ever understood was when he said, you know, I'm saying, because the rest of it, I didn't get any of, except the three things I remember was like, he convinced me not to eat pork. And I came back and my best friend's Italian and we went to get some food and I was like, I can't have sausage. And he was like, you're eating sausage. You're not converting to Islam today.
Yeah.
And then the other thing was, he went on this lengthy tirade about Juneteenth and like educating me about this stuff. And they looked at me one day and he was like, and at the end of it, and he goes, he's like, and that motherfucker's like, the white man's the fucking devil. And I was like, white man's the fucking devil, dude.
Yeah.
Totally. Dude.
You know what I'm saying?
You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
And then he had like, I don't know if you remember the
perpendicular to the square.
Right. Yeah, the mathematics, like that whole thing, dude. I got mathematic education.
I mean, I've heard like just clips of stuff where I've been like, huh?
Dude, imagine a 2 hour tour tirade, high as fuck. And then he had those fucking fronts with the fangs with all the diamonds that said RZA across the front. So then he'd be talking to you with those on as well. I couldn't understand a goddamn word of it.
Yeah.
So anyway, so I did that. So I did that for a while, which was absurd. And then I came off the road and then the record label offered me a pretty sizable promotion. And my fear was that, you know, like one of the things that I'm a music guy, like it's all I really care about, which I think is pretty obvious.
Yeah.
So my problem was that like all of the places that I went to try and find a way to make music my life, I realized that music was not the most important part of that. Like at the record label, it was just a thing. Like sell this thing. Oh, it didn't sell? Well, can we sell this thing instead?
Yeah.
And I was like, but that's a record they gave a fuck about. I'm like, yeah, no, we don't anymore.
Yeah.
So that sucked. And then working at the label was impossible. So then I started to work at this tiny little club in Porchester called 7 Willow Street, which was a really cool like 500 to 700 person venue that got the original lineup of Soul Coughing and all those like face to face. And we kind of aligned ourselves with a local radio station called X107, and through that I met the kids that threw the t-shirts out, and I was like, ooh, that looks like a good fucking job. So I went to them, I was like, yeah man, can I come and do that job? And they were like, yeah. So I did that job for about 3 or 4 months and then one day word filtered down through the staff that they had fired they'd fired the night guy and then slid everybody up. So the dude that was like a part-timer was offered the full-time overnight shift. And he had a chronic stutter, but he was also an egomaniac and was pissed that he hadn't been offered the 7 to midnight. So he turned it down. So I was like, fucking drove to the station in the tour van, went to the production guy, was like, I need to make a demo, made the demo, threw it on the program director's desk. An hour later, got hired to do the overnight.
An hour later.
Yeah. The guy was like, because I'd done radio. You know what it's like.
Like, well,
you
know, I know what I'm doing. Yeah,
it's so easy to do fucking bullshit. Like college radio is actually harder to do because you got to generate like 2 or 3 hours of content.
Yeah.
Instead of like talking every 4 songs to be like, the van's going to be at the Pig and Whistle this Thursday. Come and say the phrase that pays.
Right. Yeah.
You know that shit. So then I got hired, and then they flipped format to country and then brought me out here, and I was on a station called Y107, cleverly named, that went up against K-Rock in sort of like the late 90s, and that station got sold. So then I sort of bounced around. I worked in music videos, which I thought was going to be like the next thing. I was like, all right, maybe I'll do this, because I was like, all right, my radio career is dead, because a friend of mine has a joke that a career in radio is going on vacation with your furniture, because you literally just move every fucking 6 months to the next big gig, you know? Yeah. So I was like, I don't want to do that. I have
Such
Asperger's.
A tough business,
like,
man.
I hate moving. Like, right. I've been living in the same apartment in LA for 20 years because I can't stand the trauma of moving. So I was like, fuck it. I'm not, you know, I got offers. Because once you work in LA, it's market 2, but really it's market 1 as far as the density of the, you know, the population that you're broadcasting to. So I had offers all over the place. And I was like, I'm not going fucking anywhere. So I started working in music videos and had some really cool music videos. I worked on the Hey Ya video with Outkast, which was.
Oh, yeah.
Bananas.
You worked on that video?
Yeah. And we weren't allowed to hear the song until the day that we fucking walked in.
That's Andres, basically. Yeah. Do you know, you probably do know this, but that song became such a hit, you know?
Like, yeah, huge.
An international, like it was smashing in, you know, English.
New Zealand,
everywhere. Yeah, Japan, whatever. And they, like, I think it was like PBS did kind like not exactly what you do, but they did this like study, a breakdown of this song, and they found that it had so many like pleasing to the ear melodies. And that like parts of it they would like isolate and go, this is like a little snippet of music that basically everyone's ears
right
like, jammed to. Way that they phrased it was different.
Like, it doesn't matter what your language is, what culture you came from.
And then they were like, all the at least the way that I remember was that like Andre had written everything, and they're like, he doesn't know how to write music.
No.
So he would just be like, this is the drum, this is, and then, but not from like, you know, C major to D.
Total feel.
Just feel.
Total feel. In fact, so I worked on that video, and you remember, like, he played each of the different characters in the band.
And then
so
he'd be like five people on screen.
So we had like the telecrane, so they could repeat the same process over and over again. So I was in the art department, and one of the producers came and was like, does anybody here know how to play any instruments, because Andre doesn't, but he doesn't want to be a dick and play the bass and not have the fingering be correct to the song. Cause this is when we're shooting the video. So he's still,
they haven't even thought of this.
Hasn't even thought of this. So I hired a friend of mine for like $500 to sit in a trailer and show him how to play the bass line. Cause he wanted, when they closed up on the bass, he didn't want to be the guy who was in the wrong place of the fretboard. Yeah, like smart. He wanted to look like it was fucking real. So I worked on that video, which was amazing. And the thing with that video that was crazy was that we heard the song for the first time that morning. And then, you know, music videos, you hear it for fucking 14 hours. Yeah. And the crazy thing was, it's the first time I've ever done a music video where we were not annoyed by the song at the end of it.
Yeah.
You're driving home being like, and the first time we heard playback, right? Yeah. The first time we heard playback, we were like, holy fuck, we're working on a smash.
You just knew it.
We knew it.
Yeah.
Because it was just irrepressible, dude. And you're like, it's like going to get your cup of coffee at the shoot. And you're like, I'm fucking singing the fucking thing.
Everything. Like,
couldn't escape it.
The melody, the hook, the
vibe, the shake it like a Polaroid picture. Like all the things that he created.
Shake it. Yeah.
It's, like the iconic moments throughout the whole thing. So, but once again, the problem with it was that it wasn't about the music. It was an advertisement for a song. And then they would just move on to the next one. And I was like, I want to be able to care about the music. So then I started working at Sirius, and I was on the radio at Sirius for like 8 years, and I started doing just vocals on a show with a guy named Jason Ellis.
I know Jason Ellis.
Yeah, yeah. So I started doing the vocals with him on that show. And from there,
you would just strip out music and play vocals?
I would just do the vocals. And I tried to do a whole song, and he was like, man, I'm not really interested in going through the whole thing. Just do the vocals. And I was like, cool. So I did the vocals. It was a really good bit, worked really well. And then I left Sirius, and I started working at a place called The Sound with a guy named Mark Thompson. Mm-hmm. And that was when the first time I started doing the full song on the radio. Mm-hmm. And then I turned it into a live show. And that's really that's the whole thing.
When you say a live show, you mean
with an audience, the whole nine yards.
Go to a venue.
Yep. Yeah, I'm doing one actually coming up on the 24th of this month, July 24th. Yeah, and so basically it's a two-hour show. It's an hour per song, but this one's going to be Bohemian Rhapsody, which takes an entire fucking 2 hours to do. It's bananas. And it's all improv, and I just sit down. I have the Pro Tools screen up on a huge screen, and then I get to show pictures and sort of do the whole thing and contextualize it, and then we go through the song piece by piece by piece.
That's very cool.
So that's really what...
Where's that one going to be at?
That's going to be at a place called the Segastrom Center in Costa Mesa.
And will you be doing more of these?
Yeah, this is what I was doing before. That's why I started doing it on Instagram.
I got
Like, I was...
Oh, so it was always like a live...
Yeah.
Oh.
Yeah, so I got to the point before COVID where I was like, I was doing two shows, two weekends. I was doing a weekend in LA at two different venues. And then New York, I was doing a show... Chicago and San Francisco. So every month I was doing your fucking bit and traveling every weekend and doing it in cool venues. Like here was the two 200 person venues through MI in LA, and then a facility in San Francisco. And then my friend has a high-end audio shop in New York. So we're listening through like $500,000 stereo system, which is just fucking bananas. And it's like a small crew. So basically what I had to do was, like, similar to you guys, I would have to do what I call like break open a city, and I would have to go, and because you can't tell anybody what I do.
Yeah,
like,
it's hard.
It's the worst fucking pitch, which I kind of love.
This is the pitch, but this is the pitch.
Right, this is the pitch,
yeah.
Exactly.
Yeah.
You can't be, well, does a thing.
Do you like just hearing like one instrument?
And then another one, and then sometimes three, you know? It's like, and then, so it was really hard to elevate a pitch, which is actually kind of like a point of pride for me that you can't. So similar to the fact that it's not archived. So basically, I would have to go to a city and like do it for like 20 people in somebody's living room. And I would do it for like 6 months and get enough people for an email list and then find a 200 person venue.
It's dude.
And it was like a grind.
It's
bro.
The coolest fucking show. And like, I'll tell you, like, I went on Instagram. Again, I'll tell you, at the session IG Live, you should follow it. and you know, he'll post, like you'll see a promo, a feed shot or tags about like tonight or this week, and then you got to be there at that time, which I think is a very cool aspect of it. So I really enjoyed the Shout one. I jumped in on a couple MJ ones, and then I just happened to see, you know, scrolling through that you're doing De La.
Oh,
right.
Yeah.
And I was like, nah, like, because I thought it was just going to be like more like rock stuff.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah. No.
So I go, you got to be kidding me. So I jump in on that one. That one, I absolutely lost my mind, because not only was I a huge De La fan, and, you know, it was so fun to feel that. But the other cool thing about these is, you know, especially if you're in hip hop does a lot of sampling. So it's, you know, it's one of the fun things. There's like this one Spotify station that plays. I forget the name of it, but it plays only music
that's been used
in samples.
Yeah,
and it's so like every time you're like, oh, that's that Nas song. Yep. And it's the, you know, the show, it's a song that's 40 or 50 years old or something. So we're like, you're going through it. And then one of the coolest things I think about these is, in that case, you know, you had, there was something, I think they sampled like a Loose Ends.
Yeah, it was like the P-Funk loop and then the Loose Ends loop.
So, but then that break of like, okay, you're hearing it here, and then you start playing the Loose, and you're like, I didn't even know this song. Right.
Right.
And so, and the excitement that you feel like, because there's nothing more, like everybody is tied to usually a music that they, from a certain time in their life. And for most people, it's like, kind of like teenage years through being like 25, like that's yeah. like your foundation. I mean, you have other things you listen to, but there's that, right? And there's nothing more exciting than hearing, I think if you like music, hearing a song that you've never heard and going, oh, I like this. Like, right, this is all, this is a new
discovery.
Thing, that
yeah,
discovery.
Yeah.
And so there was the Loose Ends, and then the Cass Is Dead, Pat's Earrings.
Oh, dude, Pat's Earrings is fucking bananas.
My buddy, Jeff Tate, who's a great comic and also like a real music head and especially a Petty fanatic, right? Like, the dude, like if you were doing a Petty song, he could jump in with stories that you're like, I did not, like he just knows everything about them. So, but I know he loves music so much, so I have him, I go, you gotta jump in on this, man. So he jumps in, he's watching the De La one, and then he's like the next day, all day we're texting back and forth, Pat's fucking Earrings, man. Because I listened to it like 25 times.
Isn't that song fucking incredible?
Unbelievable.
That and dude's flow.
Dude.
Is...
Yes.
Is yes.
It's yes. But all of it, like the way,
yeah,
just even the opening, you feel like the song feels like a movie. There's
yeah,
like
no,
a
it's brilliant.
Build to it. Like
did
it's
you
a
watch
real
the video?
Yes.
With the mask?
Dude.
Like nobody knows what this motherfucker looks like.
Yeah, the fact is, like, at first shot, I was like, this motherfucker looks weird. I didn't know the mask. And then, yeah.
And then the best is that he started his career as Kaz,
uh-huh.
and then he killed it.
Kaz Is Dead.
And then he came back as Kaz Is Dead.
Unreal.
And the lyrical storytelling of that song was like, if you, I actually did I have a podcast called Man vs. Radio that I sort of stopped doing because I just got bored of it. It's a thing on SoundCloud. But I sat and actually broke it down line by line, because if you're not English, there's a lot of English vernacular and gang slang in there.
You were breaking that down, which was also, you know, Yellow Cake.
Oh, Yellow Cake and that whole fucking thing. I mean, it's like the whole, late model, the CSL on a late plate. And like Americans wouldn't understand what a late plate was. So I went and basically did it line by line. So you really
take a break from moving freight and
dude,
all that.
Taking a break from moving freight is.
Yeah. It's brilliant. It's brilliant.
It's like a story. Like it's like that thing that Rakim was so good at, which is like the story in one line.
Right. Well, there's like, that's the difference really. If you love hip hop, especially between, you know, there are MCs who are just like, well, Cat rhymes with Matt. And like that's
right.
Then there's the guys who can tell a story and have metaphor. And you're like, oh, this is, I don't know. I mean, I remember one time I had Big Daddy Kane on and I was like, so did you read a lot or something? Like, how do you know so many?
Right.
You know, and because obviously part of it is just like an innate gift.
Yes.
Like just being able to tell these stories and make it all work. It's just brilliant. But what I love about what you hosting it is, A, your enthusiasm is contagious, so that the viewer, you get enthusiastic because you see you enjoying it. But the other thing is, like, it's the same thing that's great about like a great broadcaster. If you love sports, let's say you like football, like I like watching football, there are certain broadcasters where that you realize the job of the broadcaster is to highlight things, teach you things,
right,
but not in like a condescending way. And so, you know, I'm watching a football game and you just see, like, I see, oh, they scored a touchdown. Like, that's cool. It's exciting. And then on the like immediately the expert, in this case, you're the expert with the music, but like that broadcaster goes, well, here's what, like right away, he's like, see what happened is the safety came up and the quarterback realized that he was in zone coverage. And then he turned this way and he called an audible. And then you're like, oh, I didn't even realize that happened. Yeah, yeah. And I feel like you're doing a version of that where it's like, yeah, I could listen to it and be like, yeah, this sounds cool. But you breaking it down, whether it's the slang or like what, like where that music originated from, makes it more exciting. And then you feel like you're not just enjoying the music, but you're like, you're getting more in-depth knowledge. Like you're learning something about it. So it's, well, it's an awesome experience, man.
Yeah, that was thank you. It's, you know, one of the things that when I was talking, you know, I've been in millions of skull crushing conversations with labels and TV people, yeah, and blah, 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 blah. You know, one of the things was like, well, I mean, obviously you couldn't do this with like hip hop. And I was like, no, of course you can.
Sure.
You know, I'm like, and the cool thing about hip hop is that, you know, especially if you look at that peak, like 90s era where the sampling is really at the high point of its game. I love being able to pull, because that was one of the things, like when we got into town with PM Dawn, like the first thing that I had to do was to find B, like the local record shop.
Yeah.
And then he would do a van run and go and spend
crate dig
way too much money. Yeah. And then he would sit, and I got him a 1200 and a mixer and headphones, and he would sit at the back of the tour bus and he would just needle drop. And he would just, I would just sit, see, and they'd have the back of the record and he would write like, you know, 3 minutes in, 2 second loop, blah, 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 blah. And each of them was catalogs, dude. So when he got back off of tour, he already had the framework. So as a, you know, I was a huge hip hop fan when I was coming up on Long Island, and to be able to, you know, be in the room with these dudes and like learning the culture from them. Like I had, so we had to do a radio edit of the Gravediggers record,
mm-hmm,
and Prince Paul was like not into the idea of the radio.
Yeah.
So it was like, the whole album, not the song, like the whole album. Yeah. So he hits me up and he's like, yeah, he's like, I'm not doing this on my own. I need you to come to the fucking studio with me. So we go to Hit Factory. We're sitting there and Paul is a fucking maniac. And he was like, he turned to the engineer. He's like, yeah, man, what sample libraries do you have? Because this is back in the day, like CDs, right?
Yeah.
Like the internet didn't exist. He's like, what sample libraries do you have? And the guy was like, you know, we got Racetrack, blah, 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 blah. It's Farm Animals. And she's like, Farm Animals, perfect. And we sat there and for like 4 hours crying our fucking eyes out because the radio edit version of that album, it'll be like, yo, mother, man.
And he dropped in
just Farm Animals exclusively for the whole fucking record.
That's hilarious.
Ridiculous, like 4 hours.
Really doing things for the laugh.
Which is like part of his shtick, the whole
thing.
Which
is like, it's also a type of hip hop guy. The guy that goes, like, you know, there's like the tough guys and then there's like the silly guys,
right, and
it's like,
and then there's the genius clown guy,
yeah, yeah,
who's like, if you can get a laugh out of it as well, I mean, dude, listen to Gasface.
Yeah, yeah,
Gasface is ridiculous, dude. Me, Myself and I is preposterous, you know?
I think about a lot recently, like how brilliant Shock G was, that he just passed, and like I don't think a lot of people realize the level of
meta.
I mean, first of all, his piano skills were incredible, his producing skills, creating Humpty as a character,
as a character.
Like, I didn't realize he was a character for a long time. Did you watching video? You're
right,
a kid.
Right.
You're like, they're shocked.
Yeah, yeah,
Humpty.
Yeah, right.
And then like when you see him do it, like without, and you're like, oh my God.
Yeah, yeah.
And then you realize that he created this whole thing.
Did you watch the Hip Hop Evolution series?
No. I watched the, I feel like there's a few now.
It's like five seasons.
I watched first two seasons. Cause Russell Peters, I think produced, if that's the one, did Russell Peters produce that?
No, this is Banger in Canada did this one.
Okay. Russell produced one his EP on one that's on Netflix.
Yes. He might be involved in this one.
Okay.
Is it that?
Let's see if.
Hip Hop Evolution.
Okay. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Oh, nice. So
I
Russell's
did watch,
involved.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. I watched two seasons of this. I have not finished it. And I've also heard there's a great Hulu one that I haven't gotten to where they're telling like stories.
I haven't seen that one
started
yet.
Started on FX and they're now on
Oh,
Hulu,
interesting.
And they're telling like real. Okay. In-depth stories.
Well, the one with the Hip Hop Evolution is, so they do it like basically from geographical things. So when they get to the Oakland stuff is dope because they have a bunch of interviews with Shock G.
Yeah.
And you get to realize the dude is so fucking smart. So smart. I watched
an interview with him where I was like, holy shit.
It's unbelievable.
You as a consumer, you see guys like in videos and you just think like, oh, dude, just talk shit.
Right.
You know, you don't realize the thought put into some of this stuff. And I have my own, by the way, Maceo story.
Do you really?
Yeah.
Please.
It didn't end well. So I met him at a show. He came to a show and he was like, I was opening for someone. And he was like, you are hilarious. Like, I was blown away.
Right.
You know, this is like, man, this is more than 10 years ago. And I was like, I couldn't even rap. I was like, thanks. And then he was like, you know, if you ever need music for anything, like hit me up. And I was like, what? he's like, take my number. And I go, okay, take his number. One day I just decided to call him and he's like, yeah, what's up? And I was like, just what's up, man? Started just asking questions. Did like essentially just a phone call with me and let me ask questions. He was like, no, I'm not on any of the celebrity star bullshit.
Right.
Just talked to ask him questions about making music and like when you knew it was like the right thing, when you knew it. And he was so open and honest. And then I go, you know, you said if I ever need a song. And I was making a short with my friends with like a really small budget. And I was like, I need a song for it. And he was like, all right, I'll send you some music. And he sends me tracks and we end up using one. And then I was coming back to Florida and I go, he hit me up and he goes, I'm coming to the show. I'm bringing my girl and my mom. And I was like, oh, awesome. And he comes to the show and it's packed. And I do some real off-color stuff. And at one point, they collectively boo me, like 350 people, right? And I was like, oh, shit. And then, and I had really, like, pushed, like, I won't get into that. I'll tell you But I was able to put the show back on the tracks, and like, the comedians were like, it was the kind of show where the comics were like, you really went for it on that one. That was crazy. But, like, they were, like, giving me props.
Right.
But afterwards, he was like, hey, man.
And then, that track.
Then we didn't talk again. So shout out to Maceo.
Yeah, that's a tough one.
That's a tough one, man.
You got the whole room booing you?
Yeah. It was a really offensive joke. I'll tell you off mic.
Yeah, please. I
don't need to do it in this era. It was 12 years ago, but yeah, it was pretty good.
Yeah, there was a couple times on the road. I actually tried to, a friend of mine who wrote a very, I won't throw him under the bus, but he wrote a very successful movie that actually is celebrating its release today. And he was like, we need to write the fucking story of your Gravediggers experience.
Yeah.
Like, we need to do this. And we wrote it and realized that we had to shred it immediately and that nobody could ever read it.
Oh, yeah.
It was just impossible. You're like,
these people have families now, man.
They're respected members of the community, yeah, goddammit.
Jesus.
Yeah, so it was an amazing journey to get to this point. And now this is, you know, the COVID thing was such a dick punch for obviously everybody, but I had spent so long fucking gear grinding to get to the point where this thing was something that I was doing and was generating income and was growing and really sort of building. And then it was like, and I was losing my shit and basically got saved by doing a bunch of research to work out how to plug my phone into a mixer. And then I was like, I guess this is the way to do it. And now what's crazy is that, you know, like that my favorite thing is when I'm doing it and folks like you show up and then Jimmy Jam shows up. Like Paz from fucking De La sent me a message the next day, and because we've been talking, because he started showing up when I was doing MJ.
Yeah.
And I sent him a fucking message and I was like, yo, I'm doing De La tomorrow night. And then he fucking sent me the next day. He's like, man, I fucking didn't get this message. So yeah, I'm like,
yeah.
The fact that I'm having a communication
with
Paz about De La is crazy. And then, so I did Houdini the other night.
I missed it.
Bananas good. I mean, so good. And then some guy hit me up, and obviously Ecstasy passed away, but it was Jaleel, whatever the other fella's name is. One of his friends hit me up, and I sent him the screen recording of it. And like to be able to send people that have made this music, this version of like having their, you know, all of the feedback that I get from them is to have somebody go through and show other people how much thought was in what they were doing.
Yeah.
Is like the highest compliment that they can be paid, because that's nobody consumes it. We don't get to consume it in this way. You know, and I know in between, by the way, in between like the video thing and this, I also made records for major labels, was in bands and did the whole thing. So I've also been in the room for all the moments that I'm talking about.
Yeah.
You know, like I've been in the moment, in the room when the spirit walks in and a song just plays itself in front of you and you know that you literally did nothing.
Yeah.
It just like your hands are moving.
Like the universe.
Yeah. And you're just like, where the fuck is this coming from?
Yeah.
You know? So I've actually been in the room and then having, you know, been on stage, like when I was on the road with PM, cause I love B so much. So I'd be at the side of the stage, like jumping up and down. Cause the fucking music. And he came over to me one day. He's like, yeah, man. He's like, you need to come out and fucking do that in front of everybody. He's like, get the whole crowd jumping. So I was like, that's, okay. I'm like, that's now my job. So I would come out for the two, there was a song called Plastic. And then forget the other one. But anyway, so I'd come out for them. And, you know, the Peter Gabriel tour ended at the Golden Gate Park with like 250,000 people. And you're like standing on front, and I'm not paying an instrument. I'm like literally a hype man jumping up and down, but I'm jumping up and down in front of like 250,000 people.
Dude.
And you're like, this experience is so unbelievable, man.
Yeah.
Like, you know, entertaining 200 people is one thing. Entertaining 250,000 people is one thing. So to have all of these different, and having been a drummer and a producer and all that stuff, this is my favorite thing that I've ever done because it's all of my loves in one.
Yeah. And I think you can feel it, you know, and it's just, it speaks to like how, I mean, amazing what the great equalizer that music is.
Because 100%.
It reaches, doesn't matter your background, your what you do for a living, where you're from. It's like music just, it infects people, you know, and it's just, it's so cool. So let's talk about today because we talked about, man, it was so hard. You kept sending me like fucking Motown. I was like, yeah. And then you're saying,
Motown shit is bananas.
Oh, we're going to have to do it sometime. But like we were talking about a whole bunch of options and then we finally landed on Beastie Boys,
yes,
to What You Want.
Which is, you know, like, I think, how old are you?
I'm 42.
So, oh, actually, you're fucking 10 years younger than me, you son of
I look fucking 15 years older than you, but yeah, yeah.
So the Beastie Boys are happening, for you, are they happening in real time, or are they happening retroactively?
No, they're happening in real time. It's like, so when I'm a kid, like, I remember being a kid, and it's funny because we were talking about watching the Apple documentary. As a kid, when you see Fight for Your Right to Party, you're like, that's fucking awesome.
Yeah.
But I was like 7 or 8 or something. I don't know, remember the exact age.
Yeah, you would have been 7 or 8.
Yeah, thinking that like, yeah, I get why this is popular. You know, it's like a party thing. I didn't understand what Fight for Your Right to Party meant.
Right,
I'm just thinking like that type of music to like being 7 or 8. Is
and
like,
then those three clowns.
Yeah, and they're clowning around and you're like, this is great. And then, it's basically they evolved as I evolved.
Oh, good point.
You know, so right. I would go through the different
eras.
You know, eras of them, and I saw them once live. I saw them at Universal Amphitheater when it was still there, 6,400 seat place, and it was an amazing show. And that would have been in like 2004 or 2005. And so
that's after the five Burrows record.
Yes. And they're playing live instruments,
right, of course.
And it's a show.
Yeah.
I mean, it was a real show. Stage rotates, and then everyone's has like these like kind of like wedding singer kind of suits on, but they were like they were red and black, and it was just an incredible show. And they would play, you know, songs from different albums, but like at the time that album, God, I forget the name of what had just come out around.
Then. It's not Hello Nasty. It's the one with it might be. It might be Hello Nasty.
Yeah. Pull up. Yeah. So let's see the years of release.
Oh, Hello Nasty's 92. So sorry. Hot Sauce Committee.
Right. Well, to the Burrows is 04. Yep. So I would have been, like, that would have been in to the five Burrows would have been like the new album then.
Which, by the way, if you haven't, not you, but the listeners, if you haven't checked out the five Burrows, listen to that because that's their love letter to New York after September 11th.
Yes.
So that's them talking because they had, you know, decamped to California and then they went back to New York and then September 11th happened.
Yeah.
So that's I mean, dude, because the thing about that record is you look back at all the things that they're pulling from to paint that set list together. You know what I'm saying? It's fucking bananas.
It's bananas.
Bananas. Because for me, the thing that the Beastie Boys did when I was a senior when License to Ill came out.
Mm-hmm.
And it was like the first... It was like a musical version of Jackass because it was the first time that you could see a bunch of kid, like three kids and be like, oh, these are my friends. Like these are the same people. Yeah. And then you imprinted on who you wanted to be in that organization. You know, sure. Like everybody wanted to be MCA. I was Ad Rock, which sucked. But you know, like I'm, because Ad Rock's great, but I really wanted to be MCA. You know?
Oh
like,
yeah, you sure did.
You know, that you have a, so it's kind of Did you do stuff on Sirius? Have you ever done anything over there?
I've been a guest on stuff over there.
So Sirius is the Kaiser Permanente of radio. And they, you know, like if you're a jock over there, it's you're basically just leaving voice messages. Like you're not sitting there and playing it live and all that. It's like you do the fucking show in 10 minutes and then the computer puts it together and blah, 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 blah.
Okay.
Then I would do shows like 5 days in advance so I didn't have to work. So I could just work on records. So MCA passed away on the on a Friday. And my program director called me up and was like, yo, man, you've tracked your shows all weekend and MCA just passed away. So we can't have you on the air and not be talking about the fact that MCA passed away. So can you, you know, you got to come back and redo your show.
Mm-hmm.
So I was like, okay. So I go into the studio and I'm about to crack the mic. And, you know, one of the things that I, you know, wanted to have always with my Sirius show is that it had to feel like I was doing it live, even though it was all fucking tracked. So I was like, whatever happens when I open the microphone, I has to go out. Like I'm not going to delete it. I'm not going to edit it. It's whatever happens in real time.
You're telling them this.
This is in my brain.
In your mind. Okay.
So I opened the mic and, you know, announced that MCA had passed away and I started to cry because it was a huge, he was the first of ours. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah. Like, yeah. It's meaningful to you.
It's meaningful. If you were a dude in your senior year of high school on Long Island in 1987, it's the fucking soundtrack to that whole summer. It's the soundtrack to your life. And so I got, you know, I'm an emotional poon. So I got a little bit emotional about it and then tracked the whole show. But then I had to track the whole weekend. So by Sunday, if you were listening to all 3 days, by Sunday, you're listening in the car and I'm still sniffly about it. You're like, yo, dude, you need to fucking get yourself looked at.
You need to get yourself together, man. What, were you like, guys brothers or something? Yeah.
Like, we get it.
Yeah.
I mean, it was
you're
a big
sad.
Deal, right?
All right.
But this is...
Come on.
It's a little bit much. You know what I'm saying? It's a little bit much.
Yeah, but that's how it can affect you. I understand.
Especially
that.
For, you know, this, and that's, I think, is the really beautiful thing. And then you see that in the documentary when you watch that, it's not even a documentary, when you watch that thing that they did, which is the same way to describe their book, is you realize that it's a magical tale.
Yeah. Yeah.
It's a magical, I mean, the fact that the Paul's Boutique thing. It shouldn't have worked. And the fact that the Paul's Boutique thing happens because they literally stayed at somebody's fucking house.
In
LA.
Had
a huge closet of all of those outfits.
Yeah.
And they were like, all right, this is what we're wearing.
No.
And then they wore that and then they made the record.
You know what's so cool about learning that too, though, is you realize how much most of us just doubt ideas,
right?
You know what I mean?
Yeah, good. Excellent point. Yeah, they ran with everything.
You just run. They were just like, let's fucking wear a dress. Yeah, and you're like,
what's the worst that could happen?
Yeah. Whereas, like, I feel like a lot of people, you know, myself included, sometimes you do that and you go, that's a creative thing. You did it, but a lot of times you're like, no, I can't do that. That would look. You just start second guessing it and doubting it, and like that's where kind of creativity just dies. I almost rather take that risk. And die on the risk.
Of course.
Then going like, well, I just didn't do anything.
Yep.
And you're like, well, then you didn't do anything.
Right.
Yeah.
And the thing with them is that they had each other to not only that, but it was like a closed loop, like a feedback loop of like, oh yeah, no, we better do that. I mean, that's what they say about MCA, right? It's like he would disappear and 3 months later, he'd come back and he'd know everything about mountain climbing.
Yeah.
And he'd go and disappear and come back and know everything about filming videos.
Really, I mean, unique dude.
Completely unique human being.
Yeah.
Man.
I met Ad Rock. So I'm in Montreal doing the comedy festival, and they pick you up. And during the festival, like any there's transpo's a thing, right? Van will pick you up and shuttling you around. You're doing this show, that show, and that show, and they're all over the city. So they have like a local van, teams of transpo people. I'm in the van going to the fucking venue, and I'm like looking over my shoulder. I'm like, is that fucking Ad Rock in the van with us? And this is 2011. I'm like, hey man. He was like, what's up? I'm like, what are you doing here? Why are you in the van? He's like, I'm doing this show. So he's doing a show with Bridget Everett at the venue that I like on the show that I'm on. I'm like, you're on the show. And he's like, yeah. So Bridget sings. Like she performs musically in addition to comedy. So it's like a comedy music thing. He's DJing it. So I get out of the van and I don't ever do this, but I'm like, can I get a picture? You know, I ask him. He's like, sure, man. And so the picture is I'm like, hey, and he goes, like that, and I was like, okay,
right on brand.
Yeah, right on brand. Like super upset to do it, but then he was like, all right, man. And then he walks in and he like DJs and asks for no, like no one knows.
Right. Like no
hat on.
Parade.
There wasn't like, hey, one of the Beastie Boys.
Right.
It was all about Bridget. And then about a year ago, a little over a year ago, I go to a Lakers game and my agency gave me, they have a box. So they gave me a few tickets to sit in the box. And I walk in the box right behind Ad Rock and a couple people. And dude, I mean, it's like I returned into a child. So I see him and I'm like, hey. He's like, hey. And you know what I say to him? I go, did you do the Montreal Comedy Festival in 2011? And he was like, yeah. I was like, that's where I know you from. And then he's like, cool. And then I just sit in my seat and I'm like, that dude just thinks that I know him. Right, yeah. And then, so I go through my phone and I mean, you know when you like a deep phone
search? Deep.
To find that picture. But I'm looking. And I finally pull it up. And then like there's like a break and I go, hey, check this out. And I show it to him and he goes, you just have that on your phone? And I was like, well, I looked for it. He's like, what happened to you? And I'm like, I fucking lost weight, man. He's like, all right. And I was like, I don't know why I fucking did that. And then this, I turned into a fucking
worse.
Yeah, I just turned into like a kid. Yeah. I was just, you know, I just turned into a nerd.
Because that, you know, they, as I said, like they were, you know, they were us.
Yeah.
That was the thing. Like we, it was like the same thing that happened with the Sex Pistols in London for those kids, you know. Yeah. And I've said a number of times that I feel so grateful to have been in amazing cities at amazing times. Like I got to be in England from 1977 through 1983, like in London.
Yeah.
So every day something was coming out of the radio that was like, what the fuck is an Adam and the Ants? What the fuck is a Duran Duran? What the fuck is an Elvis Costello? What the fuck is a fucking, you know,
blowing your mind
Depeche Mode?
Yeah.
Oh, The Cure, like blah, 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 blah. So, you know, the same sort of like the Clash, dude, like hearing I remember sitting on the floor of them, because there was a thing called Top of the Pops, which was like a half hour version of MTV before MTV existed, where they would count down the top 10 and then play you new songs. And it was live, shitty live performances where it was all dubbed or, you know, like faked. And I remember watching the Sex Pistols on that.
Yeah.
And just having the sneering fucking, you know, Johnny Lydon in and being like, oh, everything changes.
Yeah. Yeah.
It's different starting today. The market, you know, like music's this, about to go in
right,
a direction.
Whole
that,
other thing.
The same thing with the Beastie Boys, because it had been an exclusively, you know, it had been an exclusively black experience, hip hop up until then. And the way that I got hip hop was that I was in Long Island in Port Jefferson, which is like all the way at the end. But we could hear Kiss FM. And Saturday night's DJ Red Alert DJ'd from the Red Zone in the fucking city. Mm-hmm. So this guy is like, that's the first time I'm hearing Curtis Blow. And, you know, the first song that concaved my skull hip hop wise was Schoolie D's fucking PSK, dude.
Uh-huh.
And I was like, which I've later found out they played by hand because he didn't know how to program the drum machine.
A lot of those guys back then were doing
this
shit. Yeah.
Yeah. Like yeah. Jimmy Jam the other day was talking about how on fucking Rhythm Nation, he's like, oh dude, I played all that shit by hand. He's like, that was the way to make it feel.
Wow.
But these dudes didn't know how to program the drum machine. So they're just going, scat,
scat.
And then
doing that for a few minutes.
For a few minutes. Like, and that's when hip hop was like a 7 minute long song, dude. Like they were for the whole side of a 12 inch.
Amazing.
So I was hearing all that stuff. And Big Daddy Kane at that point was fucking starting up. So it was the first time that as a hip hop kid, I was like, that's my friends and me.
Mm-hmm.
And then all my rock friends are like, that sounds like all of us, but it's just us being dicks. Like, what is this all about?
Yeah.
So they galvanize around these three dudes and then we grow up with them and we watch them evolve, you know? And that's the beautiful thing about that documentary is like them addressing their own evolution.
Yeah. Yeah. It's cool.
And how
cool
once again, MCA is the dude who's like, yeah, man, we got to fucking
cut that bullshit.
We
got to
cut
out.
That bullshit. You know what I'm saying?
Sure.
So anyway, so let's get to the point of the bit. So, the one we ended up settling on is So What You Want, mm-hmm. which is a classic, of course, from 1992's Check Your Head. And this is so the band had left New York and they moved to Atwater back when Atwater was like a fucking war. Now it's $1 million for a fucking garage. But back then you could spend $1 million and buy Atwater.
Yeah. Atwater, for people not familiar, is like right in the Silver Lake area. You kind of cross that
bridge.
It's
like the next one over.
Next one over,
basically the gentrification
hit. Los Angeles.
Right.
Yeah.
So it went like, you know, Silver Lake, fucking Los Feliz, and then Atwater was the final one. So they were at Atwater in 92 when nobody else was there. So they built this place called G-Sun, which was, when you read the book, it's crazy. Like, it's just a recording studio. They put a skate park. They got to put a basketball court in there. I mean, it's like a fucking, it's where everybody goes.
Yeah.
And just hangs.
Yep.
And they also had Grand Royal, which was their record label and the magazine and the whole thing. And they decided on this record that they were going to do a lot less sampling and go back, because they started out as a punk rock band called the Young Aborigines, which is an amazing band name. Of course,
so bad.
Yeah, like that's what you call yourself. So they, you know, they started as the Young Aborigines, and so they wanted to get back to playing all of their instruments, and they had been working with Mario C, who plays keyboards on it, and Monty Mark, who plays keyboards on it, and Mario C was producing. So this is basically, this record is them one step further along on the hip hop evolution of the band. So we start with the drums, which is Mike D. And the thing is, like, people don't realize that Mike D is a motherfucker on the drums. Like, when you watch him live, dude.
Yeah.
Whenever I do this live, whenever I do any Beastie Boys live, I always show I get goosebumps just talking about it. Them on Letterman playing Sabotage.
Uh-huh.
There's never been a more joyous performance of a band ever, dude. They really are so fucking stoked. And they know from note one. Like, hey, like, you move on. I'm sure it happens to you, like, with a comedy set. Like, you walk on stage and you know within the first sentence whether you're about to fucking fight the next 45 minutes.
Oh, yeah.
Or if this is going to be gorgeous.
Or if this is going to be like a wave. You're just like,
I'm going to ride this fucking thing. You can tell that the minute that they hit the first note, they're like, oh, we are riding this, gentlemen. It's so fucking gorgeous. So I urge everybody to watch that performance. But anyway, Mike D on drums. And of course, they're looping it. Mm. But if we want, hold on. You know what we should do before we do that?
Mm.
Let's just... We'll show you how sick a drummer he is, because conveniently for you, Segura, we also can just quickly dip into, where is it? This is where you really get to find out the level of musicianship, because this shit's all live. So we'll just give you a brief moment of this before we go into the looping. This is Sabotage.
Mm-hmm.
And this is him playing this all live.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying?
Yeah, like, yeah.
This is some real shit.
That's real shit.
This is real shit.
It makes me wish I could play drums. Yeah.
Like, I can, and I wish I could play like this.
So interesting to hear, because you go, oh yeah, that's Sabotage, but hearing it stripped down,
I mean, like, it's straight hip-hop, but it's punk rock.
It's punk rock.
That's
hip-hop.
What they're doing. That's what they're inventing pretty much at this point. So anyway, this the one that we're doing now is they played it and then they manipulated it and looped it, but it's still him.
This is going to be a huge, by the way, Christina, my wife's going to love this, because she's a huge Beastie Boys fan.
Nice.
But she's also a huge punk rock, so like,
it's perfect.
Yeah, she loves the Beastie Boys, and her origins always like the Clash, Joy Division.
Great.
She tours as a comic sometimes around what Bauhaus is doing. So like, she's I'm going to London. I'm like,
Bauhaus
going to
doesn't
London?
Even tour around she's what like, Bauhaus does.
She's like, yeah, Bauhaus is there. So I'm like, what the fuck are you doing? Yeah,
a little comedy in Bela Lugosi's Dead is a hell of a combination.
Oh, yeah,
Thomas.
Yeah, I didn't know that.
So this sound, don't forget, is also them inventing this sound.
Yeah.
So they basically just loop this all the way through, which is... And you can hear the loop happen right where it snaps over. So then on bass, of course, you've got MCA, and once again, what we'll do is we're just going to dip back to Sabotage, because on Sabotage, so they say this in the book, and they actually have a picture of it, which I'll bring up when I bring it live. When he discovered, and I don't have it on this card, because unfortunately it's on the Sabotage card, but there's a specific distortion pedal
uh-huh.
that he discovered. And they all said when they heard him play through this, it was the sound of his soul. They were like, he was like, this is what I sound like as a human being. And when you hear him, that's why I watched that Letterman performance. He's playing through it. And this motherfucker is the coolest dude.
He's so cool.
Ever.
Yeah.
And he's literally standing there just playing this shit.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, come on.
I mean, it's just, what is this sound? Undeniable.
Yeah, it's badass.
It's badass.
Yeah.
He gets to the stops he goes to. And then he comes out of it. So that's the pedal sound that
yeah,
he's like,
dope.
And they would, and they heard him just fucking, he just, because it was typical MCA. He didn't like come to them and be like, oh my God, guys, I just got. Literally, all they heard was like him in the room one day going like, and they were like, what the fuck is that? Well, it's him discovering the sound of his soul. So he's playing on this, but once again.
This has, because What You Want also had like that filter for the vocals too.
Oh,
like
yeah.
That, I don't know what you call it.
We'll get right to that, my friend. It's all coming. So the bass is what's brilliant about this song is the bass just literally does this. That's it.
That's it?
That's it.
See, this is something you would never, I would never know this.
Nope.
I've heard this song 14,000 times. Oh, yeah.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. Oh, yeah, dude. That's dope. That's dope. God, I wish I was higher right now. That's sick, man.
It's amazing.
Yes.
Like, could you imagine, like, being in the room, these fucking three dick bags, like,
no.
living in
creating
this,
amazing, this?
Hanging out of this house in Atwater and,
oh
and, in the, and just fucking.
And they all have, like, pearls on right now and wigs.
And coming to work and being like, yo, yo, yo!
Here's me as a producer. I'd be like, you got it. This is it.
Loop it, fellas. We're good. So that's, this is literally the engine room of the whole thing. It just does this. That snare sound?
It's filthy.
Filthy.
What I love about this too, like, you know, there's a certain appeal. And I don't know if it's, maybe it's a human draw to it, but I think it happens more with men, is like something with like that just aggression, you know?
Yes.
Like the aggression of it. Just sometimes you want to feel that. You want to feel the aggression. Like that whole feel is, I don't know. It's like, it's seductive, right? You just want
to, especially if you've ever been to watched a band play in a small club,
yeah,
sounding even like, because that's where they came from, right?
Yeah.
Once again, like their punk rock roots, it's the thing that they bring to hip hop that, you know, like there were definitely, you know, black music, like Bad Brains and those people uh-huh. who they were huge fans
right,
of.
Right.
So they're like bringing all of these things, and the Dead Kennedys having people of color in that band. So these two worlds weren't separate. It was like similar to the English experience of like the Clash were as influenced by Don Letts as Don Letts was by The Clash, you
uh-huh.
know? So this cross-pollination is so vital to all this stuff. And it's one of the things that gets really overlooked is how much the Beastie Boys brought punk to hip hop and how much of hip hop they brought. There's no Rage Against the Machine without this fucking band.
Right, right.
It's impossible.
Yeah.
Because they're the guys who were doing this thing and be like, we sat here and the minute of the beat, we're both bouncing our fucking heads.
It's,
if you put a gun to my head, I'd be like, I gotta bounce my head,
yeah,
man. I'm sorry.
Yeah, yeah.
Now you just execute
and
me.
And it's
here.
What's great about just pulling from everything, right?
Like it's what they did that nobody had done prior. And, you know, they painted themselves into a corner a little bit with, you know, the whole fucking early iteration of themselves. But when you read the book, you realize that was a joke.
Yeah.
They were making fun of the dudes that they wanted
that.
To, it was
yeah.
the frat guys were the dudes they hated.
And not like if you were a kid, like I said, when you don't know that's like they were making fun of that
it was
in the
meta.
Video. Yeah.
The
yeah.
whole thing was meta, dude.
Yeah.
The characters that they picked
yeah.
were meta versions of themselves. You're like, this is, it's so smart. I don't know what to fucking do with myself. All right. So on guitar, once again, I love having Sabotage as the reference because it's where you get to hear,
yeah.
you know, listen. Everything up until this point has been clean enough to eat off of. If you think that was fucking dirty and dangerous. This guitar part that Ad Rock plays is stupid. Gross. Ready?
Oh. Whoa, that's filthy too.
Filthy.
Yeah.
It's the filthiest of all of them. All right, so that's him at his filthiest. So
hey, Ad Rock.
What do you got?
Let's give you a little taste.
That's the sound of the face.
Yeah, that is the sound of that face.
That's what that face sounds like. So he's a little more restrained on this because they're, you know, they're stacking. So he's doing, it's just this.
Oh, yeah.
So the two.
Is that the whole, like, is that all he does? The whole
he does that. And then when he gets to the chorus, he goes with this.
Right.
Which is a double tracked disaster. And then with the bass.
Oh,
so the bass on its own.
Dude.
With the guitar. And then you add the drums over the top.
Oh, dude. this is tight, man.
It's reckless. I mean, it's open hi-hats. So it's once again, it's like the Tom Morello thing of turning the guitar into the turntable.
Uh-huh,
it's
uh-huh.
The same thing, right? It's like that's the crossfade
right.
Over onto the other deck. Just imagine them laughing their fucking asses
yeah.
off.
Yeah.
Also knowing that they're killing it. Like
I know.
It's a beautiful.
And there's this thing too where that it feels like mayhem is about to begin.
It's
right?
on the brink.
It's on the brink.
The it whole
really,
time.
It really feels like these gates are about to open. You might want to get out of the
yeah.
way.
And
like,
when you see them live, that's exactly what it is,
yeah.
right? Like the whole thing sat on the edge
yes.
of chaos the
yeah.
whole time.
That's true.
But was completely restrained.
Yes.
And then was also dudes. Loving every minute of what they were doing.
And laughing and
laughing
having
their,
fun.
I mean, their friendship is, I think, you know, like the fourth member of the band.
That's so interesting to put it that way.
You know what I'm saying?
Yes.
Like, that's what's really interesting about the book that I was disappointed at in the first time I read it. Spoiler alert, MCA dies.
Yeah, yeah.
Okay?
That sucks.
So I was waiting for this fucking, you know, this a whole chapter, and it's literally one sentence.
Mm-hmm.
And it's really interesting that they chose to do that. They do more of it, I think, in the documentary. They go into a little further. Ad Rock has that beautiful thing at the edge of the stage
yes.
where he starts to choke up. But the book, it's just literally a single sentence.
About him dying?
About him dying. And that's it. And it's a really interesting way of doing it because it's not the point of the book. It's not a memorial
oh, right.
to this person. It's a framing and then the loss of him. And it's your job as you read the book to imagine what that loss must have been like. They're not yeah. going to Hallmark card it and be, you know, like, and we got phone calls and we couldn't, and we sat in the room and nope. And now you work out what we went through. Now that you've read this book and see how we felt about this person.
Sure.
You imagine what it was like to lose this dude.
Yeah, yeah.
Which is
that's a much more powerful.
So much more yeah. powerful and really, once again, unique way of doing it, which is what their whole fucking thing has
yeah.
been, dude.
Yeah, it's interesting when you go, I don't know, sometimes you see it with like actors and you go like, it feels like you've always make the right choices or something, you know? And
yep.
feels like all their choices as wacky or different or weird or unexpected, it all worked. Everything works.
Well, I think one of the things that you'll find when you read that book is you realize they weren't choices.
Yeah.
The choices were made for them
and
they just showed up to the choice.
Yeah. Which
it's,
is the lesson there is always show up, I guess.
Just show up.
Yeah.
100%. I mean, that was, you know, not that I would, you know, think in any way, shape, or form that I've done anything even remotely, but like that was the thing with the Instagram version of my show. It's like, I have to fucking try to work out how to do this.
Yeah.
And then simply by showing up, like suddenly.
So that only happened. That IG version happens only because of the pandemic.
Only because of the pandemic.
Wow. See, isn't that cool that like.
Yeah.
I keep talking about how different artists had to adapt to things, you know? Like we ended up doing ticketed streaming shows where we shot content and showed crazy content, but all of it, like, we never would have done that, is my point. Like, we only did that because we had to adapt.
I mean, you never, unbeknownst to you, I was doing this for fucking 3 years in LA, dude.
Yeah, no idea.
At least one show a weekend.
At a venue.
At a venue, selling 200 tickets.
And like, doing this.
Doing this.
I'm so pissed. I would have gone to this, man.
Well, you'll come to one. Well, actually, what I want to do is, we'll talk about it, but one of the things that I want to do is, the live show is going to keep going, but I'm going to start to, so I've done some amazing shows with actual people involved in the music themselves and had some unbelievable moments with people who did the songs. And one of the things that I want to do is like, it doesn't have to be people that worked on the songs or people in the band. Like I would love to sit and do a live version of you and I doing fucking a hip hop song that you're in love with.
Oh,
why wouldn't you want to show up and see Tom Segura lose his fucking mind? Like, you know, I'd love to. That's an amazing show.
Dude.
Music nerds unite.
Sold. Yeah. I'm in.
All right. So we have a third stem, which is, if you come to the show a lot, you realize that the extras stem is always the one that has some really cool little secrets in it.
Uh-huh.
So I forget what's on this one, but I'm sure that there's... Oh, yeah, this is the... It's not a sample.
They're playing that.
It's Money Mark fucking playing this, dude. Like, it's... Like, how do you... That showed up?
Yeah.
Like, you can literally take any kid from the 90s and be like...
Oh, yeah. Right there. Yeah.
You'd be like, oh, dude, easy. Yeah, one? Moving on. What's the next one? I want to win the car. I want to win the car.
Yeah, that's so true.
With the tambourine. And then the tambourine just goes. So that backbeat is happening the whole time. And you realize when you take it out, it loses a bit of the shuffle.
Uh-huh.
Because that tambo is holding the whole thing together.
Yeah.
Tambourine. It's a secret. So then we get to this. We get a little bit of this.
Oh.
All right. So what that
is. Oh, my God.
So what that is.
So cool,
is
dude.
That's a sample from this, which is the Southside Movement.
That's dope, dude.
Right?
Yes.
So this is I've been watching you, but
this is what I'm talking about.
I've
been watching you. See, I'll fucking download that today.
It's and dude, the whole fucking song is ridiculous.
I can tell.
Deep.
If you're putting this on at a house party, people are like, this shit's live. We're going to have a party.
So each of these little pieces that they pull out of this I've Been Watching You song are, you know, it's like fucking genius. And it's actually, there is a Big Daddy Kane. It's on YouTube. There's a Big Daddy Kane sample in this song as well. Of course.
Of course.
So you have this.
To born.
And then of course, Ad Rock. So if you add that to the guitars, it does this. And then you add the bass over the top of it. So brilliant.
Dude.
So brilliant. All right, so they bang through that, and then you get to the middle break, which is when it all goes.
Yeah.
And like, people don't understand the difficulty of making something that people cannot not bang their heads, like just bounce to. It's not easy to do, man.
Yeah.
Like, I'm like, no. You have to get some kind of biomorphic thing going on that just sits in just the right place for you to be like, oh man, I'm in. So the whole thing together. Once again, the Money Mark's organ part is playing as if it was a turntable scratching the record.
Right, yeah.
It's the push, the push and pull.
The way that he's, yeah.
It's brilliant. Which is another thing that's amazing about this group is that, you know, they surrounded themselves with equally unique fucking crazy people who bought in on the conceit 110%.
Sure.
Do you know what I'm saying? Like, there was never a point where anyone was like, I don't know, man. What do you really think? I mean,
those fucking Bismarcky ideas. Yeah, like,
sounds like it's not really. And like, no.
With the echo? With the echo?
Everyone is like buying in 110%. All right. So this is, first off, let's dip back to Sabotage real quick.
Okay.
Because Sabotage is where this microphone is actually a it's a Hello Kitty mic.
For real?
Yeah. That they had he didn't even do this. I think he did this at Mario's place. I think he did this at Marky at Money Mark's house. And he went over and he tracked the whole vocal for Sabotage at his house. And this
I can't stand it. I know you planned it. I'ma set it straight this Watergate.
So they're using just a regular mic there, and then when they get to this place, they have this distortion that this thing puts on the mic that you couldn't have created.
Right.
Doesn't would have taken you forever to be like sitting knob twiddling in a fucking studio and being a little more mids?
Yeah.
Maybe some 50K, and instead it's like, nah, man.
We'll just plug me in.
And it sits.
And that's just like some bullshit.
Some bullshit Hello Kitty microphone that they had.
Again, though, a crazy idea where like, if somebody too reasonable is around you, they'll be like, stop.
Right.
Can we have to make be a little more record. Serious about like, this?
We're not joking around, fellas.
Hello, we're wasting time.
Yeah. You know? Right. Really? Yeah. We're gonna track a whole vocal on that come back and redo the whole thing with the fucking Neumann? Yeah. But what's crazy about it is like, let it all play in its entirety in a second, but listen to how it sits. It can't get lost. You can hear every single fucking syllable, even though it's super distorted and it's on the top of this cacophonous fucking
thing. I don't
even
know why I understand it. Yeah.
It's it. You're like, okay. And then on top of that, it's a fucking Hello Kitty microphone. So let's, we'll let each verse play and then we'll come back. So that's one of the things that I do on the Instagram live version is, much as it's somewhat difficult, is I tell people shut the fuck up during the vocals because it's a very invasive thing for a singer to hear themselves.
Yeah.
With what we call protection in the industry.
Sure.
Like when you work in a studio, like it's protection, the music is protecting. And one of the experiences that I had that was really profound was I did this with Stone Temple Pilots and I did Plush with them at the 25th anniversary of Core. We went through the whole thing. And it was a great, great day playing each stem and they're telling great stories. And I have it actually on my phone. I played the vocal and we were doing it for a premiere. So everyone was sitting on headphones. So everyone outside of us didn't know what was happening inside the headphone world. So we played the vocal and immediately I see all three of their heads drop down. And I fucking tried to take a photo and the label guy took the photo and we sat through the whole vocal. And at the end of it, Dean D'Elia, who's the guitar player, the brother, he was like, I need a moment. And I was like, sure, take all the time in the world. And he when he came back, he was like, you should know that we were never allowed to hear Scott a cappella till today.
Really?
Because he was so insecure about his voice that we would track everything and then we would get booted out. And we'd go smoke cigarettes, play pool, fucking go and get some food. And he and Brendan O'Brien, who is the producer, would track the vocal, comp it, which means you take different pieces from different takes and you put together the main one. And then the way that Brendan works is he kind of mixes as he goes. So when we were invited back into the studio, we would hear it with delays and reverbs, and it was basically a finished song. So we have never heard Scott sing a cappella on any of his recordings ever until today.
That's astonishing. That even worked that way.
Just looked at them and I was like, and then at the end of it, like each of them hugged me and were like, this was a cathartic day for this band, wow. Man.
They got really emotional.
Because this was on top of, you know, I don't, if you remember, but the person who filled in for or took the place of Scott after he killed himself was Chester from Linkin Park.
And who also.
So, and he had killed himself mere months prior. And these three dudes were like, we feel like we're a cursed band.
Right.
And so for them to have this experience, like I was like, you look at this photo and all I could think of was like, what are they seeing?
Yeah.
Like what, I wish I could plug a cable into their head to watch the experience of like what of they've never heard. Think about that.
The guy that they played
this
with.
This is 25 years prior. They had never heard him the entire time, let alone this moment of their first record, of their first hits, of the first moments that the world is hearing Stone Temple Pilots.
Yeah.
And then the mourning and the anger and the fucking, like what?
Yeah, it's powerful, man.
It was powerful shit. Powerful. And I was, you know, like I left
so you
that
say,
one.
Don't talk during the vocals.
I say don't talk during the vocals because the thing is that it's a really invasive thing that we're doing and nobody's giving us permission to hear them. I mean, these guys probably don't give a shit. I don't think Ad Rock's gonna be like, oh man, I'm flat. Flat coming in off that second verse, son. Yeah. I don't think these gentlemen would
care. The other advice you give, which is great, is wear headphones.
Always.
Yeah.
And that's the only bummer about the Instagram version is that, which if you're listening to this, put headphones on because the Instagram is mono.
Yes.
It doesn't convert to stereo. So
you got to use headphones.
The experience that I'm having in the headphones which is one of the great things about the Instagram version is I'd never sat and built these stems up in my head on headphones. So me hearing this mix come together, like you're hearing it now, mm-hmm. like you suddenly hear where all these things are placed. It's bananas.
Crazy. Yeah.
And this is this shit. Yeah. Imagine if it's a fucking Yes song or, you know, like a Beatles track and suddenly you're like, what the fuck is going on? So anyway, let's listen to these three geniuses ask us what we want.
Well, just broke my ear just like I was Eddie Harris. You're eating crazy cheese like you would think I'm from Paris. You know I get fly, you think I get high. You know that I'm going and I'ma tell you all why.
So tell me, who are you dissing? Maybe I'm missing the reason that you're smiling a wild. And so listen, in my head I just wanna take them down. Imagination set loose and I'm gonna shake them down.
Let it fall like a mudslide. Oh, when I get on, I like the vibe and glide. I got depth, the perception in my text, y'all. I get pop, set my mention cause I vex, y'all.
So what you want? Are you so funny with the money that you brought? I said, where'd you get your information from, huh? You think that you can front when revelation comes?
Yeah, you can't front on that.
Which, of course,
dude,
is the great Bismarcky.
Yeah, of course. You know?
And it's like no effects or anything. It's like literally him standing in the studio talking to one of these. Yeah. Like, yeah, you can't front on that.
Can't front on that.
Yeah.
You can't front on that.
But the beautiful thing is like,
listening to it a cappella, man.
Right?
Really, yeah.
Because even with all of this distortion and this madness, which flattens everything out, the three of them are such clearly individuated people. Yes.
Yeah.
And you've got MCA on one end, and then you've got Mike D on the other, and then Ad Rock sits on the other, and then Mike D sits right in the middle of the craziness mm-hmm. and the brilliance.
Yes.
Between the two of them.
It's, the dynamic is, you know, it's
gorgeous.
Like, it's like with, I don't know, a television show, when you go like, look at the chemistry that these actors have together. It's like, it's that same kind. It just works so well.
And then on top of it, when you read the book and you realize that also when they're writing the lyrics, they're trying to crack each other up.
Mm-hmm.
Like the highest compliment that they could be paid.
Is that I laugh my ass off.
Was to have the other two be like.
Yeah.
Yeah. You know, like that shit.
You're just stupid, man. Yeah.
Which is amazing.
Yeah.
So, verse two.
Well, they call me Mike D, the never-loving man. I'm like Spoonie G. Well, I'm the metropolitan. You're screaming your horror, but my Chevy Impala. But the sweat is getting wetter and the ring around your collar.
Well, like a dream, I'm flowing without no stopping. Sweeter than a cherry pie, ready with top. If I'm mic to mic, kicking the wall to wall. Well, I'll be calling out to people like a casting call.
Oh, well, it's whack when you're jacked in the back of a ride. What you know, what you flow when you're out.
I mean, the difference between these cadences,
it's Yeah, unmistakable.
Bananas, yeah. Dude. Yeah. Like, people are like, oh, there's just guys saying shit over beat.
Pad Rock's like frantic.
Frantic.
Yeah, yeah.
And MCA is just like literally sitting there like,
chilling, man.
I mean, it's like,
I'm flowing without no stopping. Sweeter than a cherry pie, ready with top. If a mic to mic, begin the war to war. Well, I'll be calling out to people like a casting call. Oh, well, it's black when you jack in the back of the mind.
Listen to the way like Ad Rock fills in inside the beat.
Uh-huh.
Like the snare is hitting and he's inside it and MCA's on top of it and then pushing and pulling against it. It's amazing. And this shit.
Well, I think I'm losing my mind this time. This time I'm losing my mind. That's right, said I think I'm losing my mind this time. This time I'm losing my mind.
I mean, you make an entire verse.
Yeah.
Out of the same sentence.
Yeah.
You just say it differently, and it's fucking perfect.
I'm losing my mind.
Because it's exactly what you would say if you were losing your mind.
Yeah, yeah.
Well, I think I'm losing my mind this time I'm losing my mind. That's right, said I think I'm losing my mind this time I'm losing my mind.
Biz?
Yeah. You can't front on that.
It's the greatest payoff, man.
And I love that this has one of, there's an element of hip hop, especially if you started listening at the beginning of it. You don't hear as much these days, but the genre, the lane, the thought of it is, my shit is nice. Like,
right.
I'm good at this.
Yeah, this, I'm on.
I'm dope.
Yeah, yeah,
and like,
yeah.
There's, you know, there's just mentions of that throughout. That,
right.
Like, you don't really, now it's totally different and, you know, things evolve and change, whatever, but that was a staple of hip hop. Everybody had at least lyrics about how dope they are.
Yeah, <it's> like, yeah. Otherwise, what are you doing the job for, man? You're not walking up because you're insecure.
No, I'm the shit.
But little do you know about something that I talk about. I'm tired of driving us through time that I walk about. But in the meantime,
I mean, this is... It's
the wordplay, too, man. Like, it's just...
It's unbelievable. You know, like, one of the ways that I try to introduce... You know, I use... One of the tools that I use to introduce... You know, because some of my audience doesn't really enjoy hip hop.
Yeah.
Know? And to them, it is fucking a racket or whatever. And I'm like, the way that you have to listen to a hip hop vocal because of the journey that hip hop took and where it came from is, don't listen to it as a vocal. Listen to it as a trumpet solo.
Mm.
Listen to it as a saxophone solo.
Do you know that one thing that I've always had trouble with is following lyrics, because I hear lyrics as instruments.
Oh, wow.
So like in songs, sometimes I'll be like, I love this song. And I'll listen to it 100 times. And it's not until somebody like sits with me, like gets in the car, and they'll either point out like, oh, you know, like whatever the meaning of the song. I'm like, what meaning of what song? Like, and they're like, you never, and I'm like, no.
Yeah.
Like, I have to really
focus,
dial in
right.
to hear like the words and the meaning of all types of songs.
Ah.
Like even, well, it doesn't matter if it's rock. Or sometimes I'll be like, I didn't realize how fucking filthy this song was. Like, you know, I'm like, this song is all about pussy juice dripping down her leg. Like, this is crazy. But I get into like the melody of it,
right.
the sound of it.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
So like, I actually feel like I hear lyrics as instruments.
Already is that.
Yeah.
Yeah. So once you look at hip hop from that perspective and you see it as a further evolution of the jazz world,
mm-hmm.
and you realize that, you know, like I don't know if you saw that Biggie documentary, but I didn't realize this. And the one of Biggie's neighbors was this old black guy, and he was a jazz dude, and he had introduced Biggie to a bunch of stuff and was saying that basically Biggie was the drummer, because, and then they played drum tracks and then Biggie's a cappella, and you're like, oh shit, Biggie rapped as a drummer.
As a drummer.
The drum beat is the thing. So these guys, how is this not a fucking a trumpet solo?
But little do you know about something that I talk about. I'm tired of driving us through time that I walk about. But in the meantime, I'm wise to the demise. Got eyes in the back of my head, so I realize.
Well, I'm Dr. Spock. I'm here to rock y'all.
That is also, with hip-hop too, there's a very, I think there's a more limited number of people that are hard to mimic. And like,
oh, yeah.
To try to mimic that is very difficult.
It's impossible.
You know, like, I remember like first hearing like, Tretch, you know, like,
yep.
I'm like, ooh, like that, the cadence, the wordplay, breath control, Busta Rhymes. I'm like, I can't fucking duplicate that. And like, that would be hard to duplicate.
Did you hear OPP the other night?
No.
But little do you know about something that I talk about. I'm tired of driving us through time that I walk about. But in the meantime, I'm wise to the demise. God, I was in the...
In the meantime, I'm wise to the demise. The fucking mean, rhyme scheme inside the sentence.
In the meantime, I'm wise to the demise. God, I was in the back of my head, so I realize.
Well, I'm Dr. Spock. I'm here to rock, y'all. I want you off the wall. If you're playing the wall, I said, what you want? I said, what you want?
Your suckers write me checks and then they bounce. So I reach into my pocket for the fresh amount.
And then they bounce.
Yeah.
Suckers so write me checks, yeah. By the way, and then they bounce. Yeah.
Suckers write me checks and then they bounce. So I reach into my pocket for the fresh amount. See, I'm above.
I reach into my pocket for the fresh amount.
Yeah. Yeah, so dope.
It's ridiculous.
For the fresh amount. See, I'm the leaner. Victor, the cleaner. I'm the illest, but the. From here to Gartina.
Well, I'm as cool as a cucumber in a bowl of hot sauce. You got the rhyme and reason, but got no cause. What if you're hot to try? Do you think you're slicker than grease? I got news for your crew. You'll be sucking like a leech.
If you were cooler as a cucumber in a bowl of hot sauce, you're saying, my shit is nice, dude. Yeah. I'm the dopest motherfucker here.
Yeah, and then you gotta...
Do you think you're slicker than grease? I got news for
you. I got news for your crew.
Yeah,
you'll be sucking everybody. Like everybody, not just you. Yeah. I've got news for your
Call
crew.
Call your friends, man.
You're sucking like a leech.
Do you think you're slicker than grease? I got news for your crew. You'll be sucking like a leech.
And then,
you can't front on that.
You definitely
like,
can't.
Like the president just signs off on the declaration. Yes. You know what I'm saying? Like he's like, can't front on that.
That is like now a law. Yep.
So what you want? So what you want? I said what you want? I said what you want?
I wonder if, like, when they heard this playback, you know, we're talking about hearing something, when you heard Heya on the set, like, I wonder if they play back and they're like, this shit is unbelievable.
It's one of the reasons that the experience of getting to do it with the artists is really beautiful, because you get to ask them those questions. And one of the things that, you know, is unique about this experience, especially when you're doing it with somebody, is that I would imagine this is kind of true in stand-up comedy, is like, we're actually the worst people to talk about our own art, because there's like other than in hip-hop, where it's like, they just fucking, I'm the greatest.
Yes. I'm the best ever.
We don't have that. No. You know, there's like a policing of that vibe.
Yeah.
So when you can sit with somebody and look at them and be like, your shit is amazing.
Yeah.
And they get to be like, it kind of is a little bit, right?
I'm a pretty special person.
So when they get to say that, like, yo, dude, we sat there and we fucking heard this come out of the fucking speakers and looked at each other and we're like, what the fuck have we just accomplished?
Yeah.
Or, no, dude, it was track 12.
And they were just,
we had three other things to do that day.
When I talked to Gloria Stefan once about Conga. And I think if I remember correctly, she said, I wrote it on a flight, like on a napkin, on a fucking napkin on a flight.
Right.
From Amsterdam to somewhere. And I was like,
that's the genesis of the song.
That shit slaps 35 years later.
Right.
You know what I mean? Like, it's a classic. And like, that type of thing where it's like, we just needed, I don't know, I just thought of it, wrote it.
I did this at NAMM, which is the National Association of Music Makers, basically like the world's largest guitar center. It's fucking awful. But I do it for JBL at their booth. So the first time I did it, it was right before COVID, and I did What's Up with Linda Perry, which is that, hey, what's going on? That song, which was called What's Up because she couldn't call it What's Going On, because then it would have been confused with the fucking Marvin Gaye song.
What's going on? Yeah.
So, I was like, what was the genesis of this song? Because I had read that it had a confusing and shitty genesis. She was like, well, we worked with this fucking producer who had done the whole record, and we came to this song, and he had like a marching beat and a bunch of fucked up shit. And she's like, and I couldn't believe what this guy had done to the song. So I went to the record label and I was like, this guy has fucked up a hit. This song is a hit. And she's like, and all the men looked at me and were like, just leave it be. We know what we're doing. Sweetheart. We know how to make records. Yeah. We got this. And she was like, fuck though. She called the recording studio. They had one day left on the budget. They went in, tracked, mixed, and mastered the whole song in 24 hours and then presented to the label. And she was like, that's the fucking hit that I was telling you about.
And then they go.
And that song changed her life forever.
Wow. Yeah.
Recorded mixed and mastered in 24 hours, dude. And they had to stop the pressing of the album to put the fucking thing on because otherwise it was going to have the shitty version.
And then they realized.
Yeah. And Linda Perry never would have existed.
Wow. Wow. I mean, good for like having the, you know,
fucking audacity, yeah, temerity, and the self-knowledge to do that. And
amazing.
It was a really beautiful moment because she got to fucking be like, you know, this was, I knew that I was right.
I'm sorry. I'm just distracted because I missed OPP. I'm kind of upset about it. Have you done any of theirs with them?
No. No. I mean, that's my one of the things that's been really, you know, beautiful about getting to do this and having, you know, having Jimmy Jam as like my ambassador, which never would have happened without COVID. Like Jimmy just showed up one day and was like, "The fuck are you doing?"
Really?
Yeah. And then you want to talk about like amazing conversations. I had a 4.5 hour. I text him. I was like, "Yo, man, can we jump on the phone?" And he was like, "I'm an old man who likes to talk. Prepare for a long phone call." I was like, "I am the perfect audience, yeah, James Jam. We're gonna have a convo." So I get on the phone with him. 4.5 hours of what would have been the gnarliest fucking podcast. Because that dude,
yeah,
his career, bro.
Oh my god! And the stories just have to be.
He is in high school. Basically like college band, like they would let the kids would go to like a band camp at the local college coming out of high school. He's walking down the hallway one day and he hears tinkling on a piano that's pretty fucking rad, and he pokes his head in, and sitting at the fucking piano is a high school Prince Rogers. And he and fucking Prince end up fucking becoming homies.
What?
Yes, dude, in high school.
Is this in Minnesota?
Like- yes. And he was, he said, so... Two things about Jimmy is, first off, he sounds just like Obama. So the whole time I'm high as fuck on the phone and I'm having to remind myself like, yes, that I'm Mr. not President. Hearing fucking yes. Obama tell me the Jimmy Jam story.
Yeah.
And then he goes on to a spot on Michael Jackson impersonation. So now my brain's going meta and I'm having to realize that it's not Obama telling me the Jimmy Jam story doing a fucking spot on impersonation of fucking of Michael Jackson. So he said they were hanging out and like playing records to each other. And then, you know, like the next couple of days they got into the band room. And the teacher was like, or the instructor was like, "Okay, let's pick our instruments, everybody."
Yeah.
He's like, so goes to Jimmy and he's like, "Jimmy, what do you want to play?" And Jimmy's like, because Jimmy was playing drums in his dad's jazz band at 11, doing 4 hours a night. And so Jimmy was like, "Yeah, man, I'll take drums." He's like, and then Prince looks at me and was like, "Yeah, man, I thought you was a fucking piano player." So he's like, and then the teacher turned to Prince and the guy turned to Prince and was like, "What do you want to play?" And Prince was like, "I'll take guitar." And he's like, Jimmy was like, "I thought this motherfucker was a piano player."
Yeah, yeah, I'll play anything. Yeah.
Play anything. And then him and Terry met in Terry Lewis, the other half of Jimmy Jam, Terry Lewis. They met in high school and they've been working together ever since and have never had one argument.
Really?
He's like, we have never fought over anything. Yeah, these two fucking guys, who by the way, like made that vibe.
Yeah.
You know, like the Nike swoosh of producer outfits. Yeah, like you just see a silhouette of that and you're like, oh, it's Jimmy Jam, it's Terry Lewis.
Oh yeah.
So he's become like my biggest
advocate
in the industry. And it's and that's totally happened because of COVID.
You done Prince songs?
Yeah, I actually did. This was a bananas one. So the only one I have is Let's Go Crazy. And I did it one night and it started with like 150. It was sort of in the mid range when the thing was just starting to really take on a life of its own. Cause for a while I had like 400 followers.
Yeah.
So, and it was sort of in the middle age there when it started growing up a little bit. And the one at like 15 minutes in, Wendy of Wendy and Lisa shows up. Cause Jimmy had reached out to her. So She shows up and then she starts telling us fucking stories about the making of the fucking record. This is all happening in the chat, as you've seen, like fucking people just entering things. So we go through, it took 2.5 hours to do that whole song. Cause I have the full version that has the crazy jam in the middle of it, where it goes into the fucking, the version from the movie where it's like, where he's walking up and down the piano keys and that shit. So we come to the vocal and Wendy enters into she types into the chat. She's like, "Actually Prince would have fucking hated this." And I stopped it and I was like, goosebumps again. I was like talking into, I'm high as fuck. And I'm talking into the camera, into the phone.
Right? It sucked for someone and you're like, "Wait, what?"
And I was like, "This is not what I wanted to see," because it shut me down. And I was like, "Actually," I said, "Wendy, this is like one of my fears with this thing that I'm doing, especially when it comes to the vocal, is that it's so invasive that I don't want to be seen as being disrespectful and being gauche and gross in taking advantage, especially when it's somebody who has passed away, especially when it's somebody like Prince, who we know was so
controlling of his, of everything that he did for a reason, because he'd been so abused by the system, slave, let's not forget. So, you know, I said, I think the only thing that we can do is you decide if we keep going, because you're the closest person to him in this experience that we're having. And if you think that he would genuinely hate this and see this as disrespectful, then we'll stop now and thank you for this amazing night that we've had. And if you would like us to, if you think that it's appropriate for us to keep going, then we would be honored to keep going. And then you've seen it. The chat takes like 25 seconds.
Yeah.
So literally the chat shuts down and nobody says anything. And then she enters in, actually, this is a beautiful way to honor him and his art.
Wow. And you're like, okay, because I'm super high.
I'm so high. Yeah. You know, so I got a little choked up.
You're like, oh.
So then we did the whole vocal, which, by the way, is... it's so gnarly, because we don't actually, until you hear it soloed, you don't know what that song is about. And when you hear it soloed, it starts with, dearly beloved, we're gathered here to talk about it, celebrate this thing called life. And it turns into him talking to us from the other fucking side, dude, about what it is to be a human being.
Really?
And it's so gnarly. And it was very, it was more than slightly overwhelming. And then the end of it, you know, I play the whole song. And for the whole fucking 5 minutes, it just filled with Purple Hearts for 5 minutes. And it was stunning. And then Wendy hit me up afterwards, goosebumps, and she was like, thank you so much. She was like, that was something. She's like, I can't. So we're actually planning on doing that one live together.
That's
and then
cool.
She sent me a text and she was like, I know it'd be cool if I did it with you, but what if it's these guys? And then listed the whole fucking band. And I was like, much as I would love to do this with five people,
yeah, you wanna do that.
This is a 7-hour
those,
day.
And also those every
everyone's
five,
got a story.
And five mic podcasts or shows suck. It's too many people
it's
on mic.
It's a panel.
Yeah,
you know?
Yeah,
like,
dude. It's like
everyone's got a different story about how Prince came into their lives. Dude, so they blah, 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 blah.
It's like when you go to, like, I've gone to hip hop shows where they give out like 13 guys mics. I'm like, could you fucking turn a few off?
Right.
And you just hear people.
Oh, no, I've been there. Yeah, the Wu-Tang.
Yeah,
you know
what
I'm saying?
Yeah.
All right, so quickly, before, I know you have to get me out of here, but here, just as a little treat for you, this is happening at the end of OPP.
Okay.
This blew our fucking minds the other night.
This is an OPP?
This is the end of OPP coming out of the fucking last chorus. Getting started.
This is wild.
We've never heard this, dude.
Never.
This is at the 5-minute mark. The song's over.
Does it go on like this in the album version?
No.
No, they just...
he's like literally... yeah, now he gets wild, ready? So there's actually organ going through the whole fucking song that we don't realize. And it's played by a guy by the name of David Bolocchio, I believe is his name.
He's playing that?
He's playing that. And at the beginning, this is why it makes sense now when Tretch says...
Army with harmony.
He says...
Dave, drop a load on him.
Yeah. Dave, drop a load on
him. Yeah, I always remember, of course.
Is the fucking... is Dave Bolocchio, because right after that, he goes like this.
Dave, drop a load on him.
And this is buried, like...
buried!
Yeah. I've never heard that.
OPP, how can I...
That's amazing.
Amazing.
That's amazing. That's amazing.
And I was like, I just, it's like the moments I have a joke about Paul Reiser's string arrangement in Marvin Gaye's fucking Heard It Through the Grapevine, where uh-huh. I just imagine him being in the fucking mix room and being like, yo, can motherfuckers turn my shit up just a little bit more? Yeah, yeah. Like, hey, yo, Tretch, I mean, I played some pretty...
A little bit,
so you're going to do... there's not an extended
you
version
You hollered at
it?
Me by name, man. Turn it up.
I mean, I dropped a load on him, Tretch, at the end there.
This is the wildest load.
Craziness. Nobody's ever heard that fucking organ solo at the end. I'm like,
if you had just, criminal. If someone had just played that for me, I'd be like, what song is it from? I'd be like,
not
for
a million dollars.
A jazz song from the 40s?
I mean, I'll show you on the thing. So the chorus ends here, and this is all unheard. And that's where, and then the fucking organ solo is right there. Starts in the coda.
And okay, I didn't ask you this, but the acquisition of these stems, is this just from your relationships in music? Like getting these?
The internet is the Wild West.
Okay.
And when I started, so probably in 2002, 2003, when I started going to the recording studios, you'd be sitting there working with somebody, and then everyone would leave, and like the engineer would look at you and be like, all right, man, I got like three Stevie Wonder, a Who, and a Beatles. What do you got? And
you'd
be like,
all
right, dude, I got like fucking two Steely Dans and a Fleetwood Mac. I'm like, God, son, let's do this. And then you trade it.
Yeah.
And then after doing it on the radio, people started hitting me up, and now I'm friends with a lot of producers, you know, and they're giving me stuff. There was a really great one where I got a Facebook message from a dude who was like, hey man, are you the guy that does that thing on the radio? And I was like, yeah. And he goes, all right, I got something for you. He's like, meet me at the, he's like, what are you doing on Friday at 4? And I was like, what am I doing? He's like, meet me at the Starbucks at the 405 in Wilshire. I got something for you.
Really?
So I was like, am I going to end up in the trunk of a car because some Sony exec's like, all right, son, it's the right end.
You owe us royalties.
So I'm like, so I was like, okay. So I met with him, and he's this lovely guy. And he's like, me and my wife are huge fans. And he just fucking slides this USB stick across the table at me. And he's like, you're going to love what's on there. I was like, what is it? He's like, I'm not telling you. Wait till you get home. And I get home, and it's fucking 15 Michael Jackson songs.
What? Wow. All the stems.
Not even the stems. The individual safety dumps off of the 24 track. Because the way, I don't know if you noticed, but so the tapes, the old magnetic tapes, they start to disintegrate, right? Like the actual layers of them come apart. So what they had to do for a long time is they had to put them in the ovens once a year and rebake them. So the glue.
What?
Yeah, so the glues rebake the tape. But unfortunately, over time, the tape completely disintegrates. So what they started doing was they literally just sent them to archive houses, which is so fucking stupid because everybody in the industry is a fucking pirate. And if you're sitting there and you're running off Michael Jackson's safety tapes into Pro Tools and there's no one else in the room, of course you're going to be like, yeah, so this goes home with me on a drive.
Yeah, yeah.
So, you know, like, of course. So that shit happened.
So
and
you
then
got 15?
15.
Of ones you didn't have?
I didn't have any MJ, dude.
So you're like,
Thriller, Beat It, fuck, all of the hits, like name it. It's, I mean, that's why I ended up doing MJ Wednesdays, just because it just got to the point where, you know, once I went on D-Nice's thing and I was like, you know, I started doing Michael over there. I was like, that would be a really cool idea to just have this thing so that his audience and my audience would have like one place to hang out.
Yeah.
And then what's been really cool is like watching his audience stick around for Steely Dan or stick around for fucking, you know, The Cure or whatever.
Yeah, yeah. I was sticking around for Chicago the other day.
It's
man.
Amazing. Yeah. Dude, Jimmy, the best part is like Jimmy's favorite shit is like Chicago and Yes and all that stuff.
Really?
Loses his fucking, loses his mind over that stuff.
That's
loves
cool.
It. It's really, yeah, he's a classic rockhead. So yeah, Tretch is fucking shit. All right, I'll just give you a taste of your dude. This guy's, I didn't realize how sick his flow was.
His flow is wild.
OPP, how can I explain it? I take it frame by frame it. To have y'all all jump and shout and saying it. Oh, it's for other P's so people scratch a temple. The last P, well, that's not that simple. It's sort of like a wall, another way to call a cat a kitten. It's five little letters that are missing, yeah. You get it on occasion if the other party isn't gaming.
No, bro,
it seems like, I gotta start the explaining. Bust it. You ever had a girl and met her on a nice hello? Then got her name and number, then left feeling real mellow? You get home, wait a day, she's what you want to know about. Then you call up and it's a girlfriend's or a cousin's house. It's not a front of F to the R to the O to the N to the T. It's just a boyfriend's at a house, so that's why she's scary. It's OPP time, other people's, but you get it. There's no room for relationships, it's just room to hit it. How many brothers out there know just what I'm getting at? Who think it's wrong because I was splitting and co-hitting that? Well, if you do, that's OPP and you're not down with it. But if you don't, here's your membership.
I mean, the breath control, the
no punch-ins, like one take.
Yeah, wild, man. That's what I'm saying. Like, I remember, like, that was one of those songs where like you tried to mimic and you just sounded stupid.
You sound like an idiot.
Yeah, you can't.
There's one dude that can play that trumpet. You're like, you know, it's
you,
that guy.
You go ahead and take this one, man.
Stretch, it's all you, man. Yeah, drop a load on him.
Yeah, drop a load, man. Come on, Dave.
Isn't that
Dave,
a fucking
like, turn me up, dog.
Hey, you guys aren't gonna put out a fucking extended
I
remix?
I gave you my life on this, man.
He was never heard from again. It was like the biggest disappointment ever.
Dave, you ever run a date and he's like, fuck Tretch.
Amazing.
Unreal, dude.
Well, thank you for having me.
Dude, this was so awesome. I mean, I could do this for fucking hours.
I do.
I know you do. And I've jumped in. I've spent hours already on those. And I'm telling you, use this as like a commercial. Like you can do this all the time. Follow at the session IG live. Christian, it was a pleasure, man.
Thank you so much for having me in. It is it's not taken lightly, as I said. When the jaded motherfuckers are like,
dude,
I'll talk to this guy about
so
it.
It's so fun. I can't wait to go to a live one. I really want to do it with an I think that'd be so fun to do with an audience.
I love that.
That energy has got to be
Let's
incredible. And I hope we can do this again. I would love to do it
again. You can invite me anytime.
Awesome.
I'm in.
All right. Appreciate it, brother.
Thank you.